Good morning. Good to see all your smiling faces and even the ones that aren't smiling. It's wonderful to see you. Really good to see you today. Amen. You're going to have a good morning. You believe that? If you have your Bibles, I'd love you to turn to 1 John in chapter 2. 1 John in chapter 2, and we'll start reading from there in just a second. Praise God. He's good, isn't he? He's good, good, good. Gooda, gooda, gooda. So last week, I just kind of briefly, at the end of my message, I really spoke about the Old Covenant versus the New Covenant, because we were leading into an understanding that we've been forgiven of all of our sins. The old covenant never ever satisfied that requirement. It was just a covering. It was just a type and a shadow of what was actually to come in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ became the lamb that was slain. He became the one that shed his blood. Perfect blood that it was, amen, sinless blood that it was, because he was the Son of God. And not only that, but he also then at the same time became our high priest. So out of the whole covenant that he is the new covenant, the old covenant was rules, regulations, and all that. That's obsolete now. That's actually done away with. There is a new covenant that we have now in Christ Jesus. And what he did in that new covenant is simply this. What he did in that new covenant was that he actually forgave us of all of our sins. Every single man, woman, and child, God forgave us on the behalf of Jesus Christ. Okay? Not everybody has accepted the forgiveness. Not everybody has accepted the payment that Jesus made for us. But he actually did forgive us. When he said, Father, forgive them because they really don't know what they're doing right now. That was it. That was a done deal. Can you say amen? Every one of you here in this place, every sin that you've ever committed in your past, every sin that you are committing in your present, and every sin that you will commit in the future is already forgiven. So there's nothing more you can do other than believe that, receive that by faith. That's what the new covenant in Christ Jesus is all about. Can you say amen? And so what we discovered last week, real briefly, was that I just touched on one main point. And this series this month is on identity, who we are in Christ. And our truest identity is that in every part of our lives, in every single one of us here this morning, you and I will always be children, the children of God. We will be His children. We have an opportunity. It doesn't matter even when we become sons and we grow into adulthood. And when we become spiritual fathers, it remains the fact and the truth is that you will always still be His child. That means you can run back into His arms when you're in trouble. Anybody ever get in trouble? And if you have a good dad, he'll welcome you back like the prodigal father, like the father of the prodigal son. He just didn't care what he had done, how much he messed up, how much he wasted of his inheritance. He didn't care because that was his son. That's all that mattered to him. Amen? And so in every one of us, we are growing and learning to become children of God, learning to become sons and daughters of God, learning to become spiritual fathers where we can be, and mothers, where we can begin to help other believers grow in their faith also. This is what John is explaining to us in 1 John in chapter 2 and verse 12. Listen to what he says. And he mixes it up a little bit. He goes to children, to fathers, to sons, to fathers, to children. He kind of mixes it up a little bit. But he says these words, I am writing to you, dear children, because your sins have been forgiven on account of his name. This is the main point that I talked about last week on the old covenant and the new covenant. I needed to explain that whole idea that God's done away with the old covenant, and because Jesus is our new covenant, amen, that we become forgiven because of his name, because of what he's done, amen? So every child of God needs to have as a foundation of your walk with God a foundational truth that you are forgiven no matter what. That would help a lot of people. Because I'll tell you what, a lot of Christians that I have met over the years, and even myself over the years, have struggled to feel and to sense and to even know in my heart and in the depths of my being that I was forgiven. I was always trying to get more forgiveness. It was like I would nail Jesus back to the cross again. Forgive me again, please, Lord. Instead of resting in the very fact that he already forgave me. Amen. Does that mean that we don't confess our sins to him? No. Of course we do. But you know what? If we could just settle that issue right now, it would be really good for us, wouldn't it? Okay, let's move on. I am writing to you, fathers, these are spiritual fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. He makes this statement about the fathers twice. I am writing to you, young men, or sons and daughters, let's call you sons and daughters, because you have overcome, what? The evil one. Yes. Have you overcome the evil one yet? See, this whole process of becoming children, sons, fathers, this identity that we're finding out in Christ Jesus is this growing, expanding thing that we are actually learning to be able to overcome the enemy. But he's saying already that you've overcome him. And, you know, I think some of us haven't always overcome him. Because we're letting him overcome us. And that's a whole nother subject that I'm not going down today. I write to you, dear children, because you have the Father. Because you have known the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. He repeats that statement. I write to you, young men, daughters and sons, because you are strong, and the word of God lives in you, and you have overcome the evil one. He repeats that statement to the sons and the daughters that you have overcome the evil one. But what I want to focus on today is this. I'd like to focus on the sons and the daughters, which we all are. And we're growing into becoming those from children to sons and daughters. Is that right? You know, when your kids start to grow up, they start to learn, take on responsibilities. And hopefully as parents, you teach them responsibility even when they are children. Make your bed. Take your plate and clean up your plate. Drop it in the sink. It's your night to do dishes. Yeah, I know, David. It's horrible. I know. That was terrible. I was mean to my children. Isn't it true? Now I have grandchildren, it's the same thing. It's like now I'm dealing with them, and we had our grandsons over this whole week, this last week, because Sarah just had the baby, and so we had the kids at our place. Oh, I'm so glad to give the kids back. Thank you, Jesus. But the truth of the matter is that I thought, oh man, I had to go back. I've gone back in life. I've gone back in time. I had to be a dad again and look after these boys, you know. Amen. They were wonderful though. Really, they were. And so so what we're doing is we're learning to become sons and daughters of the King. Amen. And so in that, there's elements of learning to be strong in the Lord. You know, when the children of Israel We're moving on into the promised land. One of the statements that God gave to Joshua is, he said four times, he said these words, be strong and very courageous. Because now, the old generation that were unbelieving, the old generation that weren't going to take on the responsibility of the promised land because of unbelief and doubt and everything else and complaining, they've died off. I can't use them. But the next generation, I need you now to be strong and very courageous, because you're going to be moving into a promised land. You're going to be moving into the promises of God. You've got to take on responsibilities. I am with you. Can you say amen? Amen. And I'm going to be with you, but you have to learn to be strong and very courageous. And he gives them a whole bunch of points. And this is what John, I believe, is referring to also in this text here. He's saying, listen, I write to you because you are strong. Or we are learning to be strong. And that the Word of God lives in you. There's something powerful about the Word of God living in us and being in us. So in my experience, in my walk with God as a pastor and also just as a Christian, I've had to learn to be strong. I've had to learn to be strong in my faith. Because if you're not growing in your faith, and if you're not growing in your walk with God, then you are not becoming strong. The word courageous is also linked to the word strong. And basically, courageous, being a courageous person, is just a person of faith. Someone who is actually stepping out and doing something by faith, believing God. As Wendy talked about today, and as Bernie shared his testimony, how that by faith he just gave what he knew he should still give, what he felt in his heart that God wanted him to continue on giving. And you know, that takes faith. When the bills are here and the income is here to still give to God, that's really hard. I'm telling you, that's really hard. I've been there many times. And some of you have been there, most of us, we've all been there, haven't we? Say, Telstra or God? Electricity or God? Yeah, it's a toss-up, isn't it? Can I just encourage you to put God in preeminence? Put God first? Because you can never, ever, ever lose. You believe that? So, I believe that in learning to be strong, we need to do certain things. And these are some lessons that I have learned and some things that I have learned over the years. Whenever I'm in a difficult situation, when I'm in a very difficult, is it this one? This one? I thought that was, okay, that's not gone. So these are some lessons that I've learned. One of the things that I've learned, and that's something that sometimes in anything that you learn, you do well in sometimes, and then you fail at other times. Just let me give you that word to start off with. In learning to be strong in the Lord, learning to have the Word of God living in you, is that there are things that happen that we try certain things and sometimes we fail. And we step out in faith in other areas and we actually succeed. So it's this trial and error sometimes. But hopefully the longer you do it and the more you do it, the better you get at it. And the stronger you become. Do you believe that? Is that one of the things that I try to do is this, first of all, is really just try to kind of let Jesus look through my eyes at the situation that I'm in. If I can let Him be my eyes, if I can let Him be the one who's seeing the issue or the situation or the circumstance before me, and if I can take on his perspective, many times it actually helps me gauge and work it through. Can you say amen? Asking this question gives us the opportunity, if Jesus is looking at our situation, when we ask that question to ourselves, it gives us the opportunity to understand who God wants to be for us in that situation. This means we get to experience what He really is like. Because sometimes the way we approach a situation or a circumstance isn't always the way He sees it and the way that He approaches it. You catch that? And so, to bring that into place, then we can begin to learn His nature. I said last week that the more we get to know Him, the better we get to know ourselves. The longer I've known God, the more I get to know Him in my life and how He is towards us, His faithfulness, His kindness, His goodness. The more I get to know Him, the better I discover who I actually am and who I am in Him. It's a wonderful thing. When we walk with the Lord, we must learn to always connect our life situations and our circumstances, our problems, our difficulties. We must connect them with the nature of God. We must connect them with the nature of God. Because if you don't connect them with the nature of God, you will begin to approach those issues and those situations from your perspective. Yes, right. And then those situations then will overwhelm you, causing stress, causing fear, and all those things. Amen? See, the nature of God, we must always start every situation with the nature or in the nature of God. God is good. God is good.
Amen.
Bill Johnson, we've got that series on Wednesday nights on who He is, you know? That He is good. God is good. God is faithful. Did you know God is faithful?
Yes.
Have you ever felt like He sometimes isn't? Okay. Everybody good? God is loving, caring, gracious, kind. He's a provider. He's a healer. He meets needs. He's there always with us. When He told the children of Israel to go into the promised land, He actually said to them, He said, I'm going with you. I will be with you. But you have to just go together with us. One of the greatest things that I love about Jesus is this, is that Jesus says, all you that are laboring, you are that heavy laden, that you are burdened down with the cares and the pressures and the worries of life. He says, come to me. Come to me, all of you that are heavy laden, you're worried about life and things have overwhelmed you. He says, come to me. See, that's putting His nature at the forefront. And then He says, listen, and learn from me, and we will work this thing together. But He says, listen, He says, when you come to me, I'll do something in your soul that you can't do in yourself. I will give you rest. Just everybody do this with me. Just breathe out. It's a breathing exercise today. Just rest. I will give you rest for the emotional being, your being. Your soul is made up of your emotions, your will, and your intellect. So every thought that you have, every emotion that you have, because of that circumstance or that situation, He says, I will give you rest. But this is what He doesn't do. He doesn't then take it from you. He partners with you. He says, I'll give you rest for your soul, But we have to work this together. What we like to do as children, we like to give it to Him. We like to give it to Him and say, you take care of it now. He goes, no. He says, take my burden on you, take my yoke upon you, and we'll work this together. We'll plow this field together. We'll work this thing together. So it's His nature at the forefront. Are you with me? See, presence, the presence of God is everything. We sung about that today. We need to know who God wants to be for us and what He is like in Himself, His unchangingness, His faithfulness, His kindness, His goodness. We have to learn that. And the only way we're going to learn that is to actually begin to try to put Him in the forefront of everything that we're doing. What we know of God is what we will bring up in us from our inner man. What you know of God, what you know of His nature and His character towards you, will always surface when something happens in your life. Is that correct? A couple weeks ago, I spoke about in Ephesians, it talks about to the power. I'll turn there so we can get it right. In Ephesians, I said this. The scripture says, I pray out, Ephesians 3 in verse 16, I pray that out of His glorious riches He may strengthen you, what? We're talking about being strong again, right? That He might strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, that power that resides within us, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide, how long, how high, and how deep is the love of Christ, and to know His love, this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. How many of you know, if you were really filled with God, if we were completely full of God, that's what will surface in any circumstance and situation in your life. What you know of Him. As full as you have of Him is what will surface on the day of trouble. And then it says in verse 20, it says, now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power that works within us. According to whose power? His power that's working in us to be able to overcome and do things that we naturally couldn't overcome within ourselves. Okay, got to move on. One of the first things I've learned in life is that I just need to know who He is, the nature of God, and put that at the forefront of every situation. The other thing is that I do that I do when I get into a situation, I actually bring myself into deliberate and active rejoicing in God. When I'm faced with a situation or a circumstance in life, I bring myself into a deliberate and active rejoicing. Remember, let me just say this. Rejoicing is just a deliberate act of your will. That's all it is. Your will is actually cold-hearted. You just have to respond. You just have to be deliberate with your will to respond in rejoicing. Amen. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Sometimes you just got to tell your soul to bless God. Because your soul doesn't want to always bless God. Philippians, Paul says this. He says, rejoice. And again, I say,
rejoice.
Why? And you know, Paul was in a very difficult situation. He's in a situation where he is, in prison. But he had learned that the fact is that when you're in a difficult situation, what you do is you deliberately, as an act of your will, rejoice in God. And the reason why we rejoice is because and give thanks is because there's something that we do in that act of a will. It's not an intellectual thing. It's not an emotional thing. Our will is that cold-hearted part of us. But when we actually do that, what begins to happen is that we begin to kind of bring to surface who God actually is for us. Magnify the Lord and He will become magnified. And it sounds something like this. Father, I thank You that You are with me. It is an absolute given that You will never leave me. You will never forsake me. You are always going to be before me. You're always walking with me. Always constantly with me. And so I rejoice in Your presence. I rejoice that You are here even if I can't feel You right now. I can't feel Your presence. But You said that You are with me. You said You are with me, and that is good enough for me. You are here with me, and I expect to experience You to a greater degree and Your nature in this situation and in this circumstance that I'm faced with right now. This whole process, I believe, is this. When you deliberately rejoice in God, and when you deliberately give thanks to Him in that circumstance, what it does is it brings you in alignment with Him. It brings you into alignment with His purpose and His will. As long as you are complaining, as long as you are in stress mode, as long as you are in fear, you will never come into alignment with His nature and His power and His purpose for your life in that moment. There's something magical, if I can use the word magical. Maybe I shouldn't use that word magical. But there's something supernatural about worshiping God, rejoicing in God in a difficult situation, because it's not our natural bent. It's not our natural man. What we normally do is this. We react instead of respond to who He is. When something happens, let's say somebody who's close to you, a friend of yours, you find out that they are sick, they're dying of cancer. Many times, the first thing that we do, instead of waiting on God and just waiting, the moment we react. Normally, we react. We go, oh, oh. And then we start to talk to God. We go, oh God, just heal that person now in the name of Jesus. It's like this reaction. And it's really sometimes we're not really actually moving in faith. We're just reacting to the situation, to the report, the bad report. There were 12 spies. These 12 spies went over into the promised land. They all came back with the same report initially. The land is beautiful. It's fantastic. The grapes, it's milk and honey. It's the most fantastic place in all the world. And God is giving it to us. That's what God's saying. He says, that's your land. You're going to go there. It's yours. The problem is that 10 out of the 12 react to the giants. Because what they all saw, they saw the same thing. They saw, all 12 saw the giants. All 12 saw the grapes. All 12 of them saw the honey and the milk. But 10 of them, because of what was in them, hello, reacted to the giants. We cannot do this, even though God said it, and that's good enough for me. We can't take this land because they're too big. They're mean, they're nasty, and they're mighty unclean. We can't do it. Only two of them say these. Caleb says, we can do this because God is with us. See, what Caleb and Joshua did is that their reference point was the nature of God, who God is in the situation. So their confession goes, no, God can do this. We can do this because God is with us. Amen? So what happens when we rejoice and when we actually give thanks, as Paul says, what that does is it brings us back into alignment with God and His purpose and His plan and His will and His design for our life. And then he says, listen, we can do this. There's a faith. You know what? You don't have faith on your own. It's a gift. It's a gift. Let me say that again. It is a gift. There is also the gift of faith. But, you know, faith, we've all been given a measure of faith. Every single one of you have been given a measure of faith. Now, how much can we grow that? Can we become stronger in faith? Do you think we can? Yes. Is it like a muscle? Can we actually grow it? Yeah. Whatever. Yeah, we can. So if we're going to grow our faith and become stronger in the faith and stronger in the word that lives in us, we've got to actually do certain things. Do you believe that? Well, Evangeline believes it, so that's great. See, if we don't get the rejoicing and thanksgiving down as a habit of our life, let me say that again, as a habit of our life, stress will become your partner. Stress, fear, anxiety, they will all become your partner. Paul says it, he says it again, he says, listen, rejoice, and again I say rejoice, be anxious. But what does he say before that? He says, rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. And then don't be anxious. He says, the God of peace will be with you. If you pray with thanksgiving. Let your request be known to God. Let your situation be known unto God. He already knows your situation. You know, the wonderful thing about this is that God is already with you. He's with you in this. And the most glorious thing is the reason why He put us in Christ is so that every circumstance and every situation will also be in Christ. Amen. If I'm in a situation, circumstance in life, then what begins to happen is that God is with me in that. Did you hear my prayer earlier? Am I rejoicing earlier? You said you'd never leave me nor forsake me. This is an act of the will. It's not, I really feel today that God is with me. There's days I don't feel God with me. Nothing more than feelings. I'm not going to sing today. Feelings. It's not a feeling. Faith is not a feeling. Not what you can see, not what you can feel, not what you can hear. Because the reports that you hear can actually cause you to go to rejoicing, which you should do, or back into stress mode. and stress becomes your partner. Everybody okay? Make Thanksgiving a habit of your life so you actually become thanks. Who said that? Yeah. Make Thanksgiving a habit of your life and you will become thanks. You know, I've woken up some mornings where I basically, that's all I'm doing. Thank you. First thing out of my lips is thanks. Good morning, Lord, or good morning, Lord. Amen. It's an attitude of thanks. It's an attitude of rejoicing. I remember a number of years ago, my wife and myself and my four children felt called to go to Papua New Guinea. It was probably more of my calling and what I felt the Lord was saying to me about. And my wonderful wife, she came along because she's a good girl. Amen? Everybody missed a good point to say amen at that point in time and encourage me. Okay. I'm serious. She was a gem to come to with me to a foreign country and just to kind of, so we could start a church. And we pioneered a church all by ourselves in that country. And just the experiences that we had when we went there. And I remember God trying to lead me and help me to become the son that he wanted me to be. He'd given me a promise. I remember going to my father's place one day, and my dad had just returned. He was a minister, and he had just done a big crusade, a healing crusade, up in PNG, up in the highlands, and saw some fantastic miracles happening up there. And my dad had this video of PNG, and I remember walking into our TV room, and as I walked into that TV room, he had it on the video and he had it on the TV, and I just broke down crying. I just, like, I'm watching this thing happening, and I felt like God just speaks so clearly to me about that he had called me. He wants me to go to PNG. And we had just started pastoring a church in Midland at the time. So I approached the people that we were associated with at the time, and they offered to support us, which was wonderful. I mean, they were going to support us in our ministry in starting a church in Port Moresby, PNG. So we decided, okay, we're going to go. So we packed up all of our bags, our clothes, and everything, and we sold everything that we owned, and here in Australia, here in Perth. And we traveled to PNG, and I had a friend, a guy that I met in PNG a few years beforehand, who told me he was a missionary, and he said, listen, all you have to do is come in on a tourist visa, and within a month, you should just be able to get a permanent residential visa to stay in the country. So I said, fantastic. If it's that easy, I'm going to do it. So we arrive in PNG. Sarah, my daughter, who's just given birth to my beautiful granddaughter, she was 1 year old. She just turned one. That's how long my kids were just young. You know, this was a real step of faith. Listen to what I'm saying. Even though we knew we were being supported financially, this was a step of faith. This was in response to what I knew God was calling us to do. So to take my family, my little family, my four children, my four little children and my wife, and go to another country. That was a very violent country. There was crime. It was very crime-filled nation. It still is. It's even 10 times worse now. And it's just, you know, one of those situations. We got robbed. All kinds of things happened to us in our life when we lived up there. My son David never was able to ride a bike properly because every bike we ever bought him got stolen. I think we bought about four bikes for him. It's funny. Did somebody turn off all the ACs and stuff like that? I'm getting warm in here. You all cold or you all hot?
Hot.
Hot. Okay. Can we turn that AC back on? Where was I? There you go. The bikes, okay. So what we ended up doing is we arrived in PNG, and we were going to stay at a place called Mapang Mission, which was basically just a little house in the city where we were only allowed to stay there for a couple of weeks. Then we had to find a house to live in. So we arrived 13 suitcases on a tourist visa. Immigrations are looking at me going, how long are you going to be here for? It's a tourist visa. We're just touristing through. And he goes, okay. So we go and stay at this place. And so we were at this place for a while, Mapang Mission. And a couple of things happened is this. First thing that began to happen was that I quickly realized that we were going to have to leave the country within a month because the tourist visa only gave me a month to stay in the country. So I needed a miracle. Because we couldn't afford to leave the country and then probably go back at a later, we would have done it some way, somehow. But I just felt like, no, we need to stay here. And I need to go down to the labor department and become an organization so that the organization can employ me back into the country. And so I had to do a whole bunch of rigmarole, a whole bunch of things that we had to do so we could get a proper residential visa with the ministry that we were going to have and start up at the, up there. And so what happens is that I said, I just went to God. And I said, God, you've called us here. I thank you that you are with us, that you have gone before us, that you've not brought us this far for me to kind of now go home. We've sold everything we got. God, you got to help us. The one man that I really knew quite well was the guy by the name of Tuke, and Tuke knew this other pastor, and he took us down to see this guy, Charles Lapa. And just happened to be on the day that we went down to have a coffee with him, I was telling Charles my situation, and he goes, oh, not a problem. I have one of my best friends is the head of immigrations. See, God's showing me his nature. God's revealing to me that if I just put him first in my life, if I rejoice in him and I wait for him, he'll lead me, he'll guide me, he'll open doors that no man can shut. I remember going down there and meeting this man, taking all of our passports down with us, all the kids and mine, and he stamped him. He said, you got 6 months to sort everything out. That was wonderful. But now the next thing happened was the house we were staying in, the place where the holiday home and the Mapang Mission, we had to get out of there within a month. The lady kept saying, you got to go, you got to go, you got to go. So what I did is I reacted instead of responding. The visa, I responded to God. I responded to him because I didn't know anything else to do. But my natural instincts crept back in. See, you'll make mistakes. You'll react sometimes, and then you'll actually respond sometimes. It's the whole learning process. You say amen? Of growing in your faith as sons and daughters in Christ. And so every circumstance, every situation that comes your way, God's trying to teach you to be strong in him and courageous in him, so that the promises of God become yours. So I reacted. So in my reaction, I thought, okay, I can get a house. I can do this. We found a house, but it was like a half an hour out of the city, And it was way, way, way down in a very not a good place. And so I moved my family all down there, tried to encourage my wife and myself and everything else. You know, kids don't understand, do they? It's kind of, yeah, this is great. Yeah, it's, you know. But as adults, you go, you're screaming on the inside, and you all know. But God's just trying to teach me how to trust Him and know His nature for my life and know who I am in Christ. Amen? So anyhow, what happens is this, is I just basically end up getting this house. And at the time, this is how God speaks to us. See, when you feel settled, when you've learned these things that I'm talking about, and there's some things, points on the board. Basically, when we actually begin to try to discover and put the nature of God first, number one, okay? This is just recapping a couple of things. We put the nature of God first, correct? Secondly, we don't react, we respond to who He is. Yeah? Your natural tendency is to react. Can I do that again? But your inner man should always be responding to who He is. Thirdly, you begin to rejoice in God. Because you can't fix this thing. Only He can help you fix it. He'll lead you, guide you. You give thanks in your life and make it a habit of your life. When that happens, you'll begin to be feeling settled within your spirit and then begin to ask the Holy Spirit what He is seeing. What is He seeing? What is He saying to you? Don't move away from that place. Now, that doesn't mean that you stop working. Doesn't mean that you stop doing about your business during the day. Because what happened for me was that I began to say to God, the Holy Spirit said, what are you saying about this? What do you want to do for me in this? And He began to speak to me. And it's funny because sometimes He speaks to me through the Scriptures. Anybody ever have God speak to you through the Scriptures? God will give you a Scripture and it just leaps out in your spirit, doesn't it? Some people get dreams. Okay? So what God was trying to do in me was prepare me for something greater down the road. And this is what He's always trying to do in our lives. And so what happens is this, is that I begin to ask Him what's He seeing. And I was reading a book at the time by a man by the name of John G. Lake. John G. Lake went to Africa, and when he got to Africa, he actually got a house rent-free for the whole time he was there. And when I read that story, something leaped within me. And I said, God, is this what you're wanting to do for us? See, it starts with Him, it comes through us, then it goes back up to Him in worship and thanksgiving, correct? He spoke to me, and so what I did is this. I went to God, and then He told me, just go driving. Go for a drive. So I went for a drive every day for about a week. And I found this house right up on the mountaintop overlooking the ocean in Port Moresby, the city. I found out who owned the house, trying to cut this story down as quick as I can. And I went to these people and I spoke to them about the house. And I said, I see that your house is vacant. Girls, sit down. Sit down. There you go. I asked the people that own the house, I said, I noticed your house is vacant. And I asked the man, I said, listen, now I've got a word from God. It's a clear word from God. If you can do this for John G. Lake, then you can do it for me. The issue of our lives at the time was that we were having support money given to us from Australia, but on the rate of exchange at the time, I think we were getting, let's say, I can't even remember what we were getting, but let's say we were getting $1,000 Australian. By the time it converted into Kina, we were getting $800. So we were actually losing. And it was really strange why that was happening in PNG, because it's not a wealthy country. It's not a Western country. So it was just this really strange thing. And so we struggled from month to month to month. And I just said, God, we can't keep doing this. This is difficult. Lord, you have better for us. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And so the outcome is this, is that what God began to do is he showed me this house. I went to the people. I asked them about the house. And I said to the guy, he said, it actually was owned by the brewery, people that made beer. I went to the guy and I said to the guy, I said, listen, I noticed your house is vacant. Would we be able to move into that house? And he goes, yeah, I think so. Let me look into it. But he says, how much you want to pay? I said, we're missionaries here. Sob, sob, sob. I don't pay anything. I can't pay anything. We'd like to move into that house for rent free. That's a bit bold, wasn't it? But you know what? When you get a word from God, you can do that. Amen? And so God, so cut a long story short, he says, get back to me in a couple days. So I called him back 2 days later. I'll tell you what, those next 2 days, I really prayed. So, oh God, I read the story I don't know how many times and confessed it and said, Lord, if you can do it for John, you can do it for Steve. Amen? But I knew God has spoken to me. And the outcome is this. So we moved into that house. It even had a swimming pool. It was glorious. Overlooked the ocean, high up on the mountaintop. And I'll tell you what, that has become, let me say this, that has become a reference point of the nature of God to my life. That when I've gotten to a place where I didn't think I could make it, I would refer back to that time that he taught me to be strong in my faith in him. Strong in the nature of who he is. It's a reference point. And that it was all to get me in line with his purpose and his plan and his will for my life. Every single one of us, I know that you might not be going through something that big or radical right now in your life, but there will always be circumstances, there will always be things and setbacks and thinking, God, you know, and what we naturally try to do is work it out for ourselves. We react instead of just waiting on God and responding to him. Amen. See, when you feel settled in your spirit, ask him what he is seeing, ask him what he is saying. Ask him what he is doing. Number 6, just wait and keep checking in with him in your spirit. I think sometimes we get impatient, don't we? Anybody ever get impatient? But keep checking in with him. Stay in his presence until he speaks to you. Stay in his presence. And then when you hear his voice, when you hear him speaking to you, when he speaks, that's when you put your situation and your circumstance, number 7, into him. You good? Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father, we love you today. Wow. God is good, God is good, God is good. God, I pray this morning that you would grow us in our strength and in our faith in you. Lord, we want to be strong in you as sons and daughters. And you know what? The only way we can become strong is we actually go through lessons. We actually have to go through these circumstances. But Lord, let us respond correctly. Let's respond correctly as believers and sons and daughters. Let us respond and put everything back into the nature of God. Who are you for me in this? Who do you want to be for me in this? Lord, I want you to show up in your character, in your nature, in your faithfulness, in your goodness, your fatherly providing, as it would be, your unchangingness. God, you are so good. And help us to be settled in our spirit and rejoice and learn to be people that rejoice all the time. Don't complain. Don't whinge about it. Just keep you in stress. But learn to rejoice. Learn to activate your will. Say to your soul, soul, bless God. Soul, praise Him. Magnify Him. Give Him glory. Rejoice in the Lord. Let's stand this morning. If you're here in this place, can we? I hope this spoke to some people here today. I tried to use a personal illustration to kind of bring the whole thought together. But I want to encourage you today. Whatever circumstance you're involved in right now, whatever you feel God is saying to you about in your life right now, let Him, let His nature be the forefront of that. Amen? Don't react, but respond to Him. Always respond to Him. The natural tendency is always to react to the situation, but respond to Him. Amen. Let's worship God. If you need prayer this morning, we want to open up the altars. If you want to talk to God, even on your own, come down the front, talk to the Lord. But if you need prayer, you need ministry of any sort, they encourage you just to come down the front and we're going to pray with you. We're going to just, you know, help you. Maybe you don't know Jesus as your Savior, but you want to know Christ in your life and give Him your heart and life. You'd respond this morning and come down the front. Give Christ a chance in your life. Amen. If you would like those notes, because they are recapping and activation points. Okay? They will refresh your memory. I can get some printed off and maybe hand them out next week. Okay? Okay, would you like those? Because I think sometimes I can preach a message and you can go, oh yeah, oh yeah. But then we forget it as the week goes on. Amen? So if I can give you those activation points, so whenever you're in a bad situation, that'll help you. Amen? Praise the Lord. Let's worship God. What do you-